2015 meeting of the Reading Board of Selectmen to order. I'll briefly review our agenda for this evening. Mr. Arena had been previously available for an office half hour. We will have our normal reports and comments, Selectmen's liaison reports, public comment, and the town manager's report. Under discussion and action items, we have a presentation scheduled on nicotine, e-cigarettes, and vaping products at 7:30. We will have a brief discussion, but not a vote, on the intermunicipal agreement with Wakefield for the post program for special education students at 8:30, and a preview of the subsequent town meeting warrant. At 8:45, followed by review of the town manager evaluation form and discussion of next steps following that, and approval of minutes from the July 21, 2015 meeting. So with that, I'll begin to my left with Selectman's liaison reports.
Yeah, I actually attended the, I believe they called it the topping of the library. I'm sure everyone probably got that call.
I couldn't make it.
To get in there. Yeah, I was actually glad that I could make it. It was kind of a last minute thing, but I was able to definitely sneak it in. And it's pretty interesting. It's something, you know, you learn, it's one of those things, you learn something new every day. So what they do is they have a ceremony, you know, albeit a small, very casual ceremony, to put the highest beam on the new construction portion of the library addition. And they call it, you know, a topping ceremonies. So along with it, they have the beam itself is a different color than the rest of them. I believe all the staff got a chance to sneak in and sign the actual beam itself before they put it up. And they put it up and they leave it up for as long as they can until they actually put the roof on with a small little pine and an American flag.
Right, you always have a Christmas tree on top of the American flag.
Yeah, I guess I didn't realize this until someone mentioned that day. I guess it's a tradition where it was always felt that a tree should be higher than the tallest building.
Yeah.
And so as they're constructing it, they want this gives it that little extra height to making sure that it's the tree is the tallest thing during the construction period. And it literally stays up there until they put the roof on. So it was, you know, fun little ceremony actually to attend. It was nice to see and it was actually well attended by a good amount of folks that were able to stop out over there. You know, Barry Berman's wife and son were able to make it over there as well too.
It was our liaison.
Yeah. So it was nice.
And things apparently are still on schedule with the construction.
Yeah, I spoke. I spoke very briefly to the project manager there, and he said everything is on pace right now. So that was good news to hear too.
Anything on the firearms?
Yes, we had another meeting for the firearm ad hoc committee, and this meeting was basically based around we have whittled down and gone through probably a 4 to 5 different drafts of revision. I think I've brought this up before. The suggestion of town council is once we decided that what we had on the bylaw right now, just even from a language standpoint, legally speaking, really wasn't that, didn't make a whole lot of sense. His suggestion was don't try to piecemeal this back together, just start with a fresh one. So we started working on that, and we kind of whittled it down to one draft that we discussed and voted on at the time. John Halsey also was there, called in remotely for a majority of the meeting. Barry Berman attended the meeting as well thereafter. John Halsey was no longer remotely called in. So. And there was we voted to put forth for the review of this full board the final draft that we felt was a fair draft version to both address public safety concerns and also property rights. So that's what you'll be seeing in the near future, I'm sure.
Okay. Kevin, was that version universally endorsed by all members of the committee?
The vote at the time was a 5-1-0 vote. John was no longer remotely called in. We have 7 members, so it was a 5-1-0 vote. But for the most part, it was.
So was it John the 5-0?
What's that?
Was John the 0?
John was a 0.
It was 5-1 because you didn't have. He wasn't in the quorum.
Ah, okay, 5-1.
Okay, very good.
Yeah. I had occasion to meet along with Chairman Ensminger. Chair and Vice Chair of the School Committee and Superintendent Doherty, along with Town Manager LaLashier, to talk about a series of topics that interest both the town and the schools as we find ways to operate more efficiently together, and I'm sure you'll be hearing more of that as time progresses. This is kind of a kickoff meeting on a bunch of general topics, so I'll let you elucidate to further if you'd like.
I think that's good enough. It's the first of a series of meetings we anticipate, and with everything progressing well, I would say, at this point.
Yep. Very, very positive response from all concerned.
Okay. Anything else?
That's it.
Okay. In addition to that meeting, I attended a meeting of chair of the CONSCOM and chair of the CPDC and some staff members yesterday. This is to discuss the acceptance of private roads. As you may remember, there are a number of private roads in various degrees of readiness for acceptance. There are a number of legal issues. There are cases where bonds have been literally, we don't know where the bond money is, but there are some waivers we can use to excuse anything we just can't complete in the acceptance process. But essentially, we have to make sure all the lots have been released, I's have been dotted, T's have been crossed, and it looks like we'll be able to bring four or five of these to the fall town meeting. So this will be on, I think, our Jennifer 15th.
Either the 1st or the 15th.
Yeah, there's a placeholder for it on the
You'll be voting on the 15th.
Warrant that we will talk about tonight. Were there some additional easements we're going to have to talk about acquiring?
I don't think for this town meeting
we don't have to.
I didn't get an update today.
There may be utility easements that were not properly secured across residents' lots with this buried pipe. So that will need to be dealt with, but that should not hold up the street acceptances.
So the pipes are there, but the easement is not?
Yeah, we don't have a right to to service the pipes right now. So the staff has done an enormous job on clearing up a lot of messed up records that go back as far as 30, 40 years ago. Nobody's fault, things get shuffled, but going forward, we should have a better system of tracking this. Also, I'm pleased to report that at long last, the pedestrian light at the intersection of Bay State Road in Salem is functional. It's a, you're welcome. It's a big flashing yellow. You can't miss it, and I checked it out and it indeed stopped the cars, and I was able to walk my dog across. So I'm very happy with that.
Right.
That's all I have. Bob?
Try the public next. Yeah.
Oh, sure. The public. Is there any item not on the agenda that anyone would care to comment on at this time? Hearing no comment. Oh, it's your turn.
On the developments that take a long time theme, finally got the state to put in a Burbank ice arena sign that actually points towards the ice arena instead of into Camp Curtis.
that was sporting.
They got a lot of recruits there.
That's something that Mr. Burbank had been interested in for some time, and I'm really impressed. Brad Jones just basically camped out in someone's office until the sign went up, I think. So we're very, very grateful for that going up. The Library Building Committee met last Thursday. And I'd say, generally speaking, the project is still on time and on budget, but there's definitely some red flags for the first time, and we went over them extensively. The contingency so far is fine, but instead of having $800,000, we weren't sure how we're going to spend, it's down to about $200,000.
So
They hit a lot of ledge. The removal techniques they were trying, consistent of just continuing to pound it, was not working. So they've actually had to go out and get some kind of an oil rig. So I'm hoping we're going to hit oil. But it's a pretty serious step.
Price is under $50.
I know. Well, the timing is everything. They are very concerned that they can't blast because they're afraid the old structure might fall down. So you don't want to blast. But the ledge has been quite a challenge. And the core borings had not discovered this ledge, not the extent of what it is. And literally, they've tried redesigning and thinking about other ways. It's mostly for the drainage system. There's just no other way. The ledge has to go.
Yeah.
And it will. And again, it's not that it's a threat to the project. It's just why you have contingency. And now we know where some of that money is going.
Is the ledge completely remediated with the reduction in the contingency, or is there more risk for the ledge?
We don't know yet until the new equipment comes in and starts working on it. So if that doesn't work, I'm not sure what plan C is, to be honest with you. I didn't hear any doubt in the room that this would work, but it hasn't yet, so I guess we'll see. So just, a bit of a caution that the project still is in very good shape, but instead of being in an A-plus shape, it's now A-minus, and it might slip to B-plus, but it's still going well. In terms of timing, we're still broadly looking at July 1st as the opening date, sometime in the summer. the lease at the temporary space runs past that, so there's no issues there. So staff can move up when they want to. I was invited to a police academy, Reading Police Academy graduation today at the high school. It was very nice. I'm sure the board recalls when we have badge pinning ceremonies how nice it is here. Well, this was 44 officers and their families, and if you do the math, 44 officers had standing room only in the Performing Arts Center. That's how many families and friends came.
Wow.
For 44.
My goodness.
We have one officer, Tim Barrett, graduated in this class. And then there were other communities. I remember seeing three from Melrose. There were a couple of threes, but it was pretty spread throughout, actually south of Boston as well. It's a very impressive ceremony. The Reading Police Academy has been running now, I guess, for 5 or 6 years. And, you know, there's a shortage of police academies around generally, and this one seemed very impressive. This class set the record for physical fitness. Not only did they set the record, they apparently blew away the old records.
That's good to hear.
And they were very proud of that. That was a goal they had at the beginning. I know I wouldn't have want to mess with any of them. I think the rest of my report's in writing, and I'll just defer to that. I will mention that town meeting, you'll get a little bit of a preview later. Plan on at least 2 nights, it may be 3, just for your planning. Thanks.
Okay, thank you, Bob. Do we have the person here from Melrose who's making the presentation on the e-cigarettes? Is that, they're not here yet?
I guess not.
All right, we can take some other items out of order. This intermunicipal agreement with Wakefield on the POST program for special ed students. The reason we're not able to vote on that is that the school committee you want to give the...
Yeah, I can tell you about that. The school committee voted a version sometime in the past and allowed the superintendent to have some editorial leeway. Town Council in Reading and Town Council in Wakefield, since it's an intermunicipal agreement, just came to terms, I guess, since Friday. I don't want to say what day this week. And the superintendent requested that it go back for a vote of the school committee. I don't think there was a substantial change, but he just felt more comfortable if the school committee would vote it. So they will do that on August 31st. You will get it on September 1st. School starts in Wakefield sometime in the early September, but it's not September 2nd like Reading, so that's fine. Because the school committee is voting on the 31st, in your packet you'll just see the draft, and presumably they'll approve it, but if there's any changes, I'll bring it to you the day of September 1st. I don't think there was anything particularly controversial. It's just the lawyers hadn't worked out some of the language yet.
Bob, for those watching, can you say maybe a few sentences on what the POST program is?
We're responsible for, after graduation care of some of the special ed students. And effectively, this is a way where one community is running a program and both communities can benefit from it. So it's just cost sharing, program sharing, if you will.
Thanks, Bob. Let's jump to the approval of the minutes for July 21st, 2015. Everyone had a chance to review those? Okay. We have a motion to approve.
Move to approve the minutes of July 21st, 2015.
Second.
Okay. That's been seconded. A comment? No, I can't find it. Go somewhere else, I guess. Okay. Any discussion? All in favor?
Hang on. On page 3, there's a reference where we talked about the election machines.
Yes.
And the reference here says that the quote is, John Arena asked if the machines preserve a paper copy, and the town clerk said they do not. But they give a tally and the ballot's put up in the machine and locked up. Mm-hmm. The paragraph's a little clumsy. It then goes on to say that there is an image. So maybe make it clear that they produce an image, not the original paper document, but an image of the original paper document, rather than saying they don't save anything.
Yeah.
That's my only change.
Just bear with me a second here.
It'd be really hard to do a recount if you don't have something, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, all those in favor of the minutes as amended? 3-0, motion carries. Let's start the preview of the subsequent town meeting. I think we can get through that in probably 15 minutes.
I think so. You would kindly turn to page 2 of tonight's handout. Under the first article, reports, we have a couple of additional ones to the usual ones. Moderator Alan Foles will be in to see you on September 1st and ask you to set up an ad hoc 375th celebration committee. So he also wants to say a few words in front of town meeting that night. I'll give a very short Birch Meadow update and ask the group for some choices as to phase two for the Birch Meadow project. The last I knew, we had almost 600 responses to a survey. You know, that'll certainly be interesting for town meeting to see, but we really do want town meeting's feedback on some choices. And they should expect an April town meeting to see the last part of that capital project with, you know, with their guidance and their help.
Do you expect to use the voting tools?
I think so, yeah. Yeah, that seems really helpful. It's quick.
Yeah.
Colleen O'Brien and Dr. Doherty will both be in to give their State of the Union, as it were, and that'll wrap up reports. We don't obviously know any instructional motions yet. We will have some capital projects to amend and approve. We do have two prior year bills. One is a legal bill from the school department, the TLT litigation, and another is a very small, I guess it's a plumbing bill from several years ago that they just unearthed. 2016, there will be a lot of budget moving around. On balance, we're looking at using free cash of right now less than $500,000. I can't say for sure how many other moving parts there are, but you'll hear from the town accountant at some point, certainly before town meeting, that a lot of budget was turned back to free cash at year end, so we're in really good shape.
Do you know where FinCom's head is at in terms of their recommendation?
I don't yet. No, they haven't met since the end of June.
Okay.
We don't meet until sometime in the middle of September. There'll be three zoning bylaw changes. The first is the purpose. You remember the purpose went down to defeat the September town meeting.
The table of contents.
It's been streamlined. CPDC has approved it. The language is already vetted by town council, so that's in its final form.
Tracks Arlington's or Lexington's?
It's actually a blend of Lexington and Reading, I learned today. It's got some Lexington flavor, but it still has a lot of the Reading words from before.
Soft, chewy Reading Center with a nice crispy Lexington.
The telecommunications bylaw is extremely long. It's got to be 5 to 7 pages. It's really quite intense. That has been approved by CPDC and is in theory in its final form, but I did send it back to town council today and asked him if he could perhaps be a little briefer because it is so long. But there's a lot of detail. It's a very dynamic area of the law, and you know, we need to get it right. The zoning bylaw for aquifer protection is not yet complete. That'll be approved at the CPDC meeting on August 24th. It's in draft form. They've had some discussions. They actually didn't have a quorum last night, so they couldn't meet. So they'll approve it in some form on August 24th.
Just a comment about this. Go ahead. Go ahead.
I thought previously we had, the town meeting had voted to, and I'm going to get the words wrong, set aside or amend the aquifer protection such that we're on municipal water and therefore recharge of a reservoir wasn't.
Well, there are still some state requirements that are minimal, but I saw Jeff Hansen, chair of CPDC, in this meeting on Monday, and I asked him, are you guys going to do this, you know, pare this back so it meets compliance with the state and doesn't go beyond that?
It's a state minimum. It's not, this is not because we have local reservoirs or local aquifers.
Right. They still technically require us to maintain it as long as we have wells on standby, which we do. Our wells are not formally completely closed yet.
Right. But they're at the extreme north of the town.
Yeah, so I agree with you hydrologically. We're talking about bureaucracy here.
Okay.
It doesn't make any sense.
So if they were an inch over the border, it would be fine.
Probably. Just another note on zoning bylaws. The Supreme Court recently made a ruling on sign bylaws, which has effectively nullified every sign bylaw in the state. Okay, because you can no longer
regulate
purpose.
Where is Bill Brown in the room when you need him?
He's building a sign. So
can you therefore we continue to regulate size, or is that also
yes? Okay. Within limits
right. And location,
but you can as easily have a 2 by 3 foot political sign as you can a for sale or a,
of course,
you know, my mother is great sign
yeah
on your front yard. Now you can regulate
that's
the number of such signs, but and the size, and I don't know even about the duration of placement, if that's allowed.
I don't think so, but the location, yes.
Yeah, so we'll be able to see year round. Anyway, there's a lot, needless to say, Ray's got to rewrite the bylaw for like all those towns. He's starting with one of his simpler towns, he claims.
But I imagine since it's universally set aside that the bounds of what must remain or what will replace it is going to be uniformly applied throughout the Commonwealth. In other words, everyone's in the same boat.
As soon as they can interpret the four or five different opinions that came out of the court, it was a total hodgepodge from what Ray said. So it's far from definitive exactly what the requirement is. And it may have to go through some case law. And in any case, we're a year away from probably any revisions because of a pretty far-reaching.
One quick go back, Bob, on the telecoms bylaw. I'm struggling to remember what is that addressing the local utilities, telecoms utilities primarily? And
placement of cell towers.
It's cell towers. I can't forget the exact phrase, personal equipment, it's personal communication.
Okay, all right.
Cell towers.
Makes sense.
Yeah, cell towers.
Great, thank you.
Okay.
That's the three zoning bylaws. Then I have a couple bylaw changes I'd like to ask the board to look at. One is removal for absence, and that's related to the fact we now have a charter that speaks to this, so the bylaw should just sync up with the charter.
So this is absence from any board, committee, commission?
The bylaw used to say that a board, committee, or commission had a right to remove them if they were absent so many times. This just my suggestion will be to point it towards the charter that says what the removal process is.
Was that just for FinCom previously?
No, it's actually broader. We only used it in FinCom, from my recollection, but it was broader.
And is that charter language specific with regard to percent of attendance?
No, the charter language just says if a board wishes, there's different paths, but if a board wishes to dismiss one of its own members for whatever its reason,
it may do so.
It may start the process. And the charter, what the charter did especially well is protect, if you will, the volunteer from the process. So they have full notice, mm-hmm. full rights, they can have an attorney, so forth. It's very clear. The next one is a discussion we had at length in the Charter Committee, and it's something that I'd like you to talk about. It's whether or not to have a residency requirement. The Charter more or less used to require that. It used to imply that. The bylaw absolutely requires it. Mm-hmm. Now the Charter is silent on it, so it's up to you whether you want a bylaw or not. And, you know, I'll just reflect some of the discussion we had with the Charter Committee that there could be instances where a business owner or any expert that lives across another border from another town may be a real good addition to a board, right? Just because they're not a Reading resident, is that really a good enough reason? And I will tell you, in the past, there have been non-Reading residents on boards. Right? You know, if someone moves, you don't always know. It's just not an unreasonable thing to have. So I think that's something you should discuss.
Have you drafted anything for that?
I do, and I'll share that with you.
Okay.
It's fairly straightforward.
Okay.
Is the intention there, Bob, to make it an unqualified, or is it qualified by?
I've drafted just delete it. So if you want to have some kind of conditions, you're obviously welcome to do that.
I think something like that certainly puts a lot more awareness for the volunteer appointment subcommittee.
Right.
When making appointments, I think to what you were maybe just commenting on, is there a good fit, or is it someone looking to?
You could imagine a bunch of great reasons why a non-resident would want to participate. I can come up with an equally impressive list of bad reasons.
Absolutely.
I mean, the Permanent Building Committee may be a good example there where we're having a hard time covering all the particular expertises from the available pool in Reading.
Right.
People may have conflicts of interest. It's a lot of time, that kind of thing. And whereas someone from a town over could fill the bill nicely. That's not a particularly political group. It's a very objective.
Yeah.
So that could be an area. So I hope that allows some degree of participation, but maybe has some safeguards against a majority not being from out of town.
Yep. Animal control bylaw. This is the second worst bylaw that the AG has seen. I won't tell you the worst one, but it was also Reading. We've since fixed that one.
Yeah.
Ray is committed to rewriting this in its entirety.
Okay.
And importantly, some state law has changed over the last year, which is we had been going to bring this forward before, and we realized we should wait. The state law is now complete. So
we just wind up aping the state law pretty much?
We're going to try to do that as much as possible. Yeah. So
no pun intended.
About it.
There wasn't, actually. Yeah.
Kevin has spoke to you about the bylaw change that'll be in front of you, and then also Dan has mentioned the road acceptances, and there's a draft list. We have six on the list. So we're very hopeful that all six of those will make it.
For the public, Causeway Road, Corey Lane. This is, Dividends Road from...
Oh, yeah, I don't remember this, but it's a portion of Dividends Road.
It's the portion that goes out onto...
The portion goes onto Franklin.
Franklin.
It's from Franklin to...
The first intersection, yeah, that's it.
That's right.
Pondview, which is, goes north off of Fairchild, Roma Lane, and Sailor Tom's Way, which is where the boat used to be.
Right. So there's your two night town meeting, maybe three.
Okay, stay tuned, more to come. Our guest from Melrose is here, I believe.
Come on up, Maureen.
Come on up. Welcome, Ray.
You're early.
Yeah, we're done with our agenda except for you. Do you review the town manager? Thanks for coming in.
Thank you for having me.
Could you introduce yourself to the...
I sure will.
People in Reading Land here?
Sure. I'm Maureen Busby. I'm the tobacco program coordinator for seven communities, including Reading. And as the tobacco program coordinator, I do enforcement, education and awareness, and I work on policy with local communities, that is, communities who have an appetite for changing their current policies to basically, since we're into youth prevention, to make the access of tobacco products harder for our youth. So to keep me on track, I did prepare some remarks because it is a big subject and I can kind of get off on a tangent and go everywhere with it. So I thought about what you might be interested in, how I might quickly get through the remarks I wanted to make tonight and allow enough time for questions. So, get to page one.
Well, there's only three of us, so you should have only 60% of the questions you were going to have.
That's
answers.
A help.
Yeah.
So my goals tonight are to, one, share with you the latest concerns facing us about tobacco and nicotine use among our youth, and those have changed. In the 4 years that I've been in this position, those concerns have actually changed quite a bit. To tell you about recent local policy actions, including an important announcement last week by Boston Mayor Marty Walsh, and mainly to answer any questions you may have about anything related to tobacco and nicotine. And then at the end of my prepared remarks, I can show you some samples of products that I'll be referencing. Before I start with my remarks, I'd really like to congratulate Reading on how progressive you've been on adopting new regulations. A few years ago, we didn't need to worry about something called nicotine only. We worried about tobacco products, and there were some tobacco regulations on the books. But once nicotine delivery devices like e-cigarettes and e-hookah came into being, those tobacco regulations did not apply to any of the newer products. So towns like Reading, boards of health took it upon themselves to look at their regulations and see what they could do to make sure that these newer products had the same prohibitions that a regular conventional tobacco product that we were used to had. And among the things that you folks did, you added language so that the electronic nicotine delivery products are treated like any other tobacco product, or any tobacco product, I should say. You have to have a permit to sell them. We can inspect the stores and do regular compliance checks. Products must be behind the counter, out of reach of the customer, and they cannot be purchased by underage youth. This is not true in Woburn, for instance, where a 10-year-old could buy an e-cigarette or buy e-hookah. Reading also passed a pharmacy ban long before CVS passed their nationwide tobacco ban. And your ban covers non-CVS pharmacies, so it would affect a Rite Aid or a Walgreens or an independent. More recently, Reading increased the legal age to purchase tobacco to age 21, again reducing sales in the target age group, those under the age of 21. The tobacco industry blatantly targets young people with flavor, scents, packaging, and also price. We know that 80 to 90% of adult smokers start smoking when they were in their teens. Very few people, a non-smoker over the age of 21, will pick up the habit. The impact of not having young people start smoking in their teens is really critical because not only does smoking cause huge lifetime health concerns, data shows us that nicotine addiction often leads to other substance use and abuse. means people who smoke are more apt to drink. People who drink are more apt to use drugs. In terms of what's happening more recently, of concern to all of us, and has been reported here in Reading, is the increased use of e-cigarettes by high school and middle school students. E-cigarettes loaded with nicotine are not regulated by any state or federal agency. Cigarettes are, other tobacco products are, e-cigarettes are not. And as we conduct surveys, we are learning how misinformed the public is about e-cigarettes. Many young people, adults too for that matter, believe that e-cigarettes are not harmful. This is alarming because there are definitely known health risks associated with e-cigarette use, and what we fear even more than the known risks are the unknown risks. They just haven't been around long enough for us to study and know what the long-term risks are. There have been several recent studies reporting on increased e-cigarette use among kids. I'll mention just one of them. The Boston Globe reported in April of this year that the use of e-cigarettes, and this they reported from a CDC study, the use of e-cigarettes among middle and high school students tripled from 2013 to 2014. The increase in e-cigarette use, combined with more young people using hookah pipes, led to 400,000 additional young people using a tobacco or nicotine product for the first time in 2014. And that was also the first increase we've seen in years. The same article, it was reported that students in interviews said that e-cigarettes are almost as common at school as laptops. Many of these students have never smoked a conventional cigarette. Since nicotine harms the developing brain, this is a huge concern to public health officials. Another concern, while cigarette use has decreased over the past decade, chewing tobacco use has not changed at all. It has remained constant. 20% of our student high school students, most of them male student athletes, still use chewing tobacco, also known as chew, snuff, or dip. The good news is that civic leaders are starting to take notice. Last week, Boston Mayor Marty Walsh announced that he wants the Boston City Council to pass an ordinance banning the use of dip in all parks, public and private, meaning that this new ordinance, if passed, would apply to Fenway Park. I had the privilege of attending his press conference last week. There were several speakers who shared why they think this is a good idea. Two of the best speakers were Kurt Schilling and a former youth tobacco program activist who is now a baseball player at BU. Both spoke eloquently about why they believe the city council should pass this measure. Kurt asked who in the audience remembered the bloody sock. There were a lot of young people, so maybe only about two-thirds of the audience remembered it. He said the bloody sock on a pain scale of 1 to 10 was about a 5, very painful. His head and neck radiation chemo treatment was about a 500. Unimaginable pain. He was sick every single day for 4 months. He couldn't swallow. He was fed through a feeding tube. If he had to do the treatment again, he's not sure he would. And he blames his mouth cancer on his lifetime use of chewing tobacco, which he started at age 16. He calls it the single worst decision he ever made. He also said that back when he was playing pro ball, if he was told he couldn't chew at the park, he would have been angry. He would have felt it was wrong to legislate something that should be an adult's decision. But he knows now, for better or worse, baseball players are role models for our kids and have a responsibility to be good role models. Now the thought that his open use of chewing tobacco might have influenced some kids makes him sick. He said it's important to keep this stuff away from kids, and that means out of sight. It was pretty impactful to listen to him, and I'm glad I had a chance to be there, I think it was last Wednesday. We'll be watching this closely. If Boston passes such an ordinance, it will become only the second city in the country to do so. San Francisco already passed a ban on chewing tobacco use in all their parks, including their pro baseball park. And then lastly, what I wanted to cover was what one of our neighboring communities is up to. Last spring, Winchester passed several new health regulations related to smoking and vaping. They already had some of the major pieces in place, such as the new nicotine language to cover e-cigarettes and the pharmacy ban, and they also have a smoking cigar hookah bar ban. Effective the 1st of July are these new regulations. They now have a permit cap. Winchester will not increase the number of stores with a tobacco permit. Just be flat. I think they have 8 now. It'll remain 8. A proximity ban. It will be illegal to sell tobacco and nicotine products within 500 feet of a school. They don't currently have any stores within 500 feet of a school, but this regulation will prevent any in the future. It's a good preemptive strike by them. They now have blunt wrap ban. By the way, Reading did this a few years ago, but the blunt wrap ban wasn't one of our strategies when Winchester upgraded their regs back in 2012. Sure, a blunt wrap.
Like
so,
a cigar?
Yeah.
Okay.
So the difference is there are blunts, which
yeah.
is a big fat cigar. So those are blunts, those are legal. A blunt wrap is legal in Massachusetts, but some of our communities have decided that the way the blunt wrap is designed and used is designed for a purpose other than regular tobacco. So a blunt wrap is a big, it's a flat tobacco leaf wrapped around a plastic tube. You open it up and you put your weed instead of cutting open a blunt and dumping out the tobacco and putting your weed in that, the tobacco industry saw what everybody was doing with those, they made a blunt wrap. So you open up the tobacco leaf, put your weed in it, roll it back up, you light it, that's how you make your joint. So for some communities, the boards of health looked at that and they knew from the research that we have that people are not using those for tobacco, they're using those for drug use, and that makes it drug paraphernalia, and they passed either a drug paraphernalia ban, which would include blunt wraps, or a blunt wrap ban. So blunt wraps are banned in, I guess all of my 7 communities, I think, now have a blunt wrap ban, and Winchester was the last one to come on board with that. And then they also passed, effective 7-1, a cigar minimum price regulation. Any single cigar in Winchester must have a minimum price of $250. It can be more than $250, but it must be a minimum price. We know that, I have some samples, but we know that kids are easily attracted to something that's cheap, and right now we see in our stores 79-cent cigars, 99-cent cigars, and they're not the kind of cigar that you might want to light up after a nice meal. Those cigars are safe, and those are $250 or more already. These are the cheap cigars that kids are using and typically starting their tobacco career with. Then lastly, Winchester passed a flavor ban. It's no longer legal to sell flavored tobacco products in Winchester with the exception of mint flavors like wintergreen, spearmint, and peppermint. As you know, I'm sure, flavored cigarettes were banned many years ago by the federal government because those flavored products were targeted to kids. But that ban on flavored cigarettes does not pass on to other tobacco products. So the industry in recent years has come out with hundreds and hundreds of flavors. They have candy and fruit flavors, bubblegum, gummy bear, strawberry, peach, mango, watermelon, orange crush, blueberry mist, chocolate, vanilla, and literally hundreds of flavors.
Is the reason they kept the other flavors because they've always been that way? And they're not attributing it to any new use?
That's an excellent question. So the reason is they wanted to mirror more of the federal, because the federal law has been vetted and, you know, the suits were already filed and resolved. So they wanted to mirror that as much as possible. So in the event that the tobacco industry or a convenience store group wanted to sue a community or a state or whoever who wanted to do a flavor ban, it would likely be in good position to defend that because we know that.
Okay.
So they wanted to kind of mirror that. So mint flavored is allowed here, so we'll allow it on the other tobacco products, OTPs. So the tobacco industry knows what it's doing. It flavored these products, it scented these products, it wrapped them, packaged them a certain way, and it made them cheap. And it's worked. Because tobacco use among kids, the cigarette use has gone down, but overall use has stayed steady, and that's because cigar use and e-cigarette use and e-hookah use has gone up. And we expected that trend to continue. We've seen some very alarming trends, even locally. Takes a long time for federal agencies to act, and almost as long for state government to act. So thankfully, local communities are stepping up on this subject just as they did with indoor smoking bans. Local communities drove indoor smoking bans. The state didn't, and the federal government didn't.
Maureen, a question for you on these electronic delivery systems. One is, has any town contemplated the outright ban of them as different, fundamentally different and separate from the historical use of tobacco, stigma, cigarette, et cetera?
That's a good question. Not that I know of, and I think the reason might be because it is a legal product. There's nothing illegal about them right now. They're not regulated in any way by the federal government, so somebody can manufacture it and sell it. So to ban it would probably be to expose yourself or whatever community it was to a lawsuit that typically when there are new regulations, we like to see a larger entity like the federal government or the state or even a large city like Boston take on the first blunt wrap ban in the state or whatever, so they have more legal resources, and if there is a lawsuit, they can defend that lawsuit. And I know most communities did not take up a blunt wrap ban until Boston had defended their blunt wrap ban and they were successful, and then other communities started adopting it.
That goes to kind of the strength of the legal argument. You've kind of got some assurance that it's weathered the storm of challenges already.
Yeah.
The second question is there any evidence with the onset of the medical marijuana bylaws, there's an opportunity, would seem anyway, to have a cross product of having some of the tinctures and liquids and products that come out of that find their way into these same delivery mechanisms? And if so, are you seeing that, and is there regulations that address that specifically?
There aren't regulations addressing that specifically. I haven't seen it specifically. I've read several articles where people are concerned about that happening, and it might be worth showing for anybody who isn't familiar with what an e-cigarette looks like, and there might be somebody in the audience who hasn't seen one before.
I'll include myself in that.
Okay. So there are two kinds of e-cigarette. Well, you know what? Let me do something. Let me depart from this for a moment.
Sure.
First of all, I'd like to pass around a sample board of real-life small cigars, tip cigars, cigarillos. This is what we find that our kids typically start with because these are cheap. 69, 79 cents, two for 99, strawberry flavored, grape flavored, whatever. So kids will start with these. They're scented. The harshness of tobacco is disguised by these. Also, just look at the packaging.
It's like bubble
pretty,
gum.
You know, it's pretty gay packaging. That's appealing to kids. So that's a little cigar. Then I don't have a whole can. Somehow I lost my can of dip snuff. This is the old-fashioned can of snuff, dip, chewing tobacco. This is what most kids use. There are some newer versions, but most kids still seem to be using these. So when you see that round mark in the back of a baseball player's pocket, this is what they have in their pocket. There are newer versions like this. This is loose tobacco, so it looks like this. If somebody takes a gob of this and they put it between their cheek and their gum, you can recognize what they're doing, and it causes you to spit. So it's very hard for our student athletes to get away with using this. So the industry came out with newer versions. In this tin would be something that looks like this, and I'll pass it around so you can see. This is kind of like a tea bag material. So they wrap a more finely milled tobacco loaded with nicotine in these pouches, and you put that little pouch in your mouth and you can get your nicotine fix, but it's not as noticeable. And for whatever reason, they call this spitless, it doesn't cause you to spit like the regular chewing tobacco does. So a high school baseball player, hockey player, whatever, can use this during a game, during class, during library period, or whatever.
What's the particular ingredient that's really bad in here? Is it a tar that happens to cause the cancer and the problems?
So the addictive property is the nicotine, but there are also other toxins in there, and not just tar, but other cancer-causing. I'm not a chemist, and I forget everything that I learned in class, but there are other cancer-causing substances in chewing tobacco. The biggest problem with chewing tobacco is that it's so addictive, and it causes mouth cancer, gum. You know, the San Diego Padres Hall of Famer Tony Gwynn died of mouth cancer, and he blames his mouth cancer on his lifetime addiction to chewing tobacco. So people kind of overlook that it has the same addictive properties as a cigarette because it's got the nicotine in it and cancer cause. And once you're addicted, you use it.
I'd assume the 20% that you referenced earlier from high school students is mainly sports.
Yes.
Oriented, is that right?
Yeah.
So they're seeing it on the major league levels, and
those are their role models.
Yeah.
Exactly. Yep. Then
speaking about tobacco, when I was a dinosaur roaming the earth with My roommate used to roll his own cigarettes out of pipe tobacco because it was cheap. And I noticed just traveling around, pipe tobacco was still priced at a different class than, say, rolled cigarettes.
You're absolutely right, and we wish that wasn't true. And there are some bills in the legislature, they never pass, to try to bring OTP, so both loose tobacco and cigars and these other products, not to bring them up to the tax level of cigarettes, which is very high, but higher than it is now. And we're never successful. Right now, the Speaker of the House has proclaimed no new taxes, the State House, no new taxes. So we try, you know, every year some organization or some rep tries, and it hasn't happened yet. But we would like to see higher taxes on those products, because if you buy cigarettes or they become too expensive and then you roll your own, it's as damaging whether you roll your own. And typically, you're not even getting the filter on it.
No, you're not. I can swear to that. So.
The only trouble with that sort of taxation, it's often billed to be funding anti-tobacco programs, but it gets appropriated into the general fund, and that's really not what happens at all.
Thank you for that. Mm-hmm. So 5% of the money that should come to the tobacco prevention program, and 5% of the money that should come actually comes. So we work with 5% of the money that we
just
actually should.
Tax.
Massachusetts actually scores very low on spending enough money on tobacco prevention. We do well on certain regulations and laws, but poorly on how much money we're putting into it.
How much of our CASA, and I don't know the answer to this, is focused just on this theme of tobacco, not the drugs part, but
there's a new part-time grant-funded position that's taken a focus on this, so it's a new thing within the last 2 or 3 years.
I got to believe the attraction, if general tobacco, classic tobacco is down and the balance is being made up by the new products, it's largely because they're undetectable or it's cool.
It's absolutely. And when I get, I'll pass these around, and then I'm going to show you a little more about e-cigarettes, because these are the ones that came before e-cigarettes. So I'll show you this, and then I'm going to show you an e-cigarette, and you hit on something that we think is very important with our kids today, and that's gadget. Yeah. So this package in here, this is a big fat cigar, that's called a blunt. In this package is a blunt wrap.
Okay.
So, and again, not legal in Reading, but this, you will see these in other communities where they haven't been banned.
What's the price difference between these two products right here, generally?
That big blunt is probably about, you can probably get those for a dollar, and Dan could answer that better than I can, but the big blunt's for about a dollar. That
$1.79.
Brand, yeah. And then when you used to have blunt wraps,
About the same price.
So they're making the same money with having to put out less product.
Yeah, right.
Basically, the tobacco industry.
There's another marketing theme there if you haven't figured that out. So.
Now, this board is, I'm going to show you e-cigarettes. So this cigarette-looking thing right here is what I call the gas station or mini-mart or convenience, the gas station mini-mart or convenience store e-cigarette. This is what you would typically find. It's a single use. Some of them do have replacement cartridges, and some do have a port where you can plug it into your laptop and recharge it. But typically,
I think of everything.
The internet cigarette.
Right.
Unbelievable.
Yep, you are not kidding.
We're kidding about the e.
Except for Dan actually has some higher end e-cigarettes, which I'll be showing you in a minute. But these are the early ones. We start seeing these, then we start seeing these, and then we start seeing these. Again, I'll show you in a minute. But as this board comes around, I'd like you to take a look at this bottle of what we call e-juice. This e-juice actually, this bottle actually gets poured into this, and that's where we're going to get into your question. This is a sample e-hookah, and this is a sample e-hookah. And I've shown these to many parents and many school teachers, and they say if they saw these items, they would think it was a marker, a pen, whatever.
Yeah, sure.
I think clearly disguised. These were big items among our middle school kids. A couple of years ago, that's what I kept hearing about e-hookah. For some reason, in our communities right around here, e-hookah seems to have died off. Most of the stores that I go into aren't even carrying much product anymore. There are some other communities I hear, especially larger urban communities, where the e-hookah is still very popular. But we are seeing the e-cigarette. So as you pass that around, now I'll show you the kind of higher end e-cigarette that our kids are very into, high school kids.
Speaking of middle school, have you thought about any of this very material for parents who at PTA? meetings who don't have a clue? These look like
Yeah, I go, and when I can, I invite myself to as many meetings as I can, especially where I can talk to teachers and parents, because they're the ones most apt to see the kids with these products. They're the ones who need to know what they look like, what they are, and also with schools, what we need to do is build into the health curriculums the newer products. They do, most of those health curriculums have something about tobacco. They don't have anything about nicotine-only devices, and there's a lot of misinformation.
Unbelievable.
So, this is...
Didn't you go see the Reading School Committee a couple months ago?
I did, yes, thank you. I did. Early June, I did a I was invited to the Reading School Committee because they were concerned about what they were hearing about the increased e-cigarette use, and I did do a presentation there. In fact, I think the presentation there actually led to... this invitation. So good for them. They're concerned. They're knowledgeable. They're on it. You have a substance abuse prevention organization here in Reading that is second to none. I work with Erica and Juliana Arcasa, and they do a great job. And they always invite me anywhere they can where they think I can add to the knowledge. They have a ton of knowledge, and they have a ton of knowledge about tobacco and nicotine use. But they'll give me openings whenever they can. Okay. So. This is called a tank, or I'm sorry, this is the battery, this is the tank. So you separate these two items, and then you take your bottle of liquid nicotine and you open it very carefully because this is poisonous, and if you get this on your skin, you are actually absorbing the nicotine that's in this. And then you pour this very carefully, you can imagine some drip effect and whatever, but you pour this very carefully in here. Then you put this back together, and then you tap it, and then you puff away. And we call this vaping, and there are lots of new vape shops now. Reading doesn't have one, but Melrose has one. Malden, I think, has two. Wakefield has a vape store. They're popping up all over. They're coming out with an amazing array of vape devices and accessories that just boggle my mind when I see them. But they're also promoting their products with vape parties, or what they call cloud parties. So some people might remember back to when we had, where smokers would be proud about how big a puff of smoke they, or how perfect a circle or whatever. That's now the in thing with vape.
So is there any external attribute of this that you can smell in the room?
These are flavored. So this one happens to be candy, cotton candy e-liquid. I don't know what cotton candy e-liquid smells like, but I have smelled vanilla. I've smelled cinnamon. Yeah. I've smelled fruit-flavored ones.
That's
so
what you'll smell if you're in a room.
Exactly. You would not smell smoke. You would not smell the cigarette smoke that we identify with cigarette smoke.
So does this fall into the prohibition of indoor smoking in most ordinances?
It depends on how your new language was written. And actually, I should have checked that before I came. In most of the communities that I work in, when they change their tobacco regulations, they updated their ETS, their environmental tobacco smoke regulation, so that it includes vaping. So that it covers, so you can't vape anywhere that you can't smoke.
Is
so
it
that
the act that's prohibited, or is it the prime product that's prohibited?
So this effectively does not produce secondhand smoke, is what you're saying?
Right, it produces secondhand vapor.
Okay,
and we have no idea.
We don't know.
Yeah, exactly. This is so new. There are no studies. With secondhand cigarette smoke, it took us decades to figure out how bad that was. So many public health people are saying, don't wait until we have decades of addicted people, and then we find out that the secondhand vapor was bad. If you prohibit the indoor vaping now, and we find out 20 years from now that there's no harm, we can reverse that and let people vape indoors if that's important to people. But right now there are lots of public health people and states attorneys general who are pushing the FDA to pass regulations because there are no regulations on e-cigarettes. We have no idea what's in them. A lot of them are produced overseas. We don't know the manufacturing conditions under which they're produced. If a machine that fills pesticide bottles is the one that next is going to be filling these bottles, we don't know. These are not childproof caps, although Maura Healey, our new Attorney General, has proposed some regulations, and her regulations would make the selling of e-cigarettes to anybody under age 18 illegal, as well as she's looking for childproof caps.
Sure.
So this also comes with a charger.
Of course.
And so this is the very cool gadget for kids. And there are fancier ones than this. And kids tell me they just love them. And when I ask kids, why do you use these? They're cool. And then the second reason, they think they are harm-free. Mm. There's no smoke. So they've been drilled, you know, for years they've heard about how bad smoking is, or secondhand smoke is. There's no smoke. So to them, that makes this harm-free. And there's less chance of any combustion kind of thing. So we know that most residential fire deaths are caused by improperly disposed of smoking materials. That's not as apt to happen with these, although we do know of fires in airplane cargoes that were started by e-cigarettes. So there is a danger there. Less than discarded cigarette, but again, so what I wanted to.
Same with a cell phone battery.
Yep, cell phone batteries. Yep.
Yeah.
Yep. So not harm free, some harm. The biggest harm that we're concerned about is these are loaded with nicotine, and kids that are using them, many of them have never smoked a conventional cigarette. So while some retailers and manufacturers are touting these as smoking cessation devices, if somebody's using them who's never smoked before, they're not using them as a smoking cessation device. The other thing I've heard, and by the way, I do know people who have used e-cigarettes to quit smoking.
Does it work?
For some people.
Yeah.
They said, I've tried patches, I tried pills, I did this, I did hypnosis, I did everything. I've tried 40 times, I was never able to quit.
It's got the oral part without the...
All right, so they reduce the nicotine gradually?
Yeah, exactly. They can go from, you know, 24 to whatever down to zero. And so some people are successful with it. But for some people, the whole drill of that vaping and so on, that's part of the addiction,
yeah.
And they need to do that. And so they end up... And what I've heard from some people is they are now dual users. They smoke where they can smoke, and they vape where they can't smoke. So now there's a concern that people are actually getting
more
nicotine. At least when we passed indoor smoking prohibitions, then people had to go outside to smoke. And it not only caused some people to quit, it reduced the amount of smoking that smokers did just because they couldn't do it as frequently.
Right.
It's like one avenue you have immediately open to is the compounds that are vaporized are tobacco byproducts. No debate, right?
No tobacco.
The little bottle of liquid you had, is it
right.
tobacco
no.
byproduct?
Just the nicotine.
No.
Just nicotine.
Not the tar, I guess.
We don't.
Yes.
Yeah,
children
that's right.
Poisonous.
Is that not a tobacco derivative?
Well, it could be, but we don't know because there are no regulations. We don't, unless we test these and go back, you know, we don't really know.
You don't know
where
the pedigree
it comes
of that
from.
Fluid, I see.
Yeah. So, and in fact, there are many products out there, that, especially e-hookah, it'll say zero nicotine. And those have been tested and found to have nicotine in them. So we just don't know. Without regulation, we can't know.
On a slightly, it's related topic. You mentioned the blunt wrap, and that kind of crosses over into the world of marijuana
yep.
and recreational use. And we're probably going to be having a ballot initiative on that in 2016, from what I'm hearing. Has anybody looked at the whether or not marijuana produces many of the same health effects as regular tobacco, in that it's probably got some tar in it, it's probably got other substances that could be carcinogenic. Has anyone looked at that?
I would imagine people have. I don't happen to know of any
yeah.
studies, and I haven't read any studies, but I can't imagine that somebody...
It's looked at like
yeah,
completely different.
Exactly.
Lead.
Yeah. And we do have, you know, our substance abuse prevention folks are very concerned about marijuana use and how that for many, well, first of all, tobacco is often the first substance that kids use,
right.
followed very quickly by either pot or alcohol or both. So folks who work with drug addicted kids and alcohol addicted kids are very concerned about that very subject. So I'm sure studies have been done. I haven't been made aware of any.
I'm almost shocked that it doesn't publicize more.
Yeah.
Maybe it's not politically correct.
Yeah. I bet. And you're right, you know, as this comes closer to when the question is on the ballot, I'm sure we're going to hear more from both sides, those who are going to defend recreational marijuana and those who are going to
be concerned. Yeah, there's
going to
be a real hard sell coming on that, I'm sure.
Absolutely.
I'm just poking around here on the web. There is an analog to that nicotine. There is liquid tetrahydrocannabinol.
Mm.
That it's got all the same characteristics.
Yeah.
It's got odorless, it doesn't have any smoke byproduct, and it's apparently unregulated.
Yeah.
So
you can actually do a joint that way, too.
Yeah. I believe it is regulated in Colorado and Washington, and they actually use it in a liquid vape type things.
They allow it to be used in liquid form like that?
In those states where, you know.
Yeah, marijuana is a plant. It's not a compound, so the compound's not regulated.
Okay.
You have a challenge on your hand. We have a challenge on our hand.
Fortunately, you have some good boots on the ground here in Reading, and you've
very
done
grateful for that.
Yeah, exactly. You've done a great job trying to keep up. So, the things that I'll be working with the Board of Health on is any additional regs that they want to try to bring forward and have public hearings on to further strengthen the restrictions that are in place now. Because the goal is to keep these kids out of the hands of our kids. Because if kids reach age 21, they're not going to become smokers. So if we can stave off that addiction until then, that addiction is unlikely to happen. So that's the goal. And if we keep these flavored products, these fancy wrapped cheap products out of the kids' hands, then we have a better chance of keeping them from becoming users of these products.
I've always been one to be very pro-merchant, and I don't like undue restrictions on what people can and can't sell, but I have to say that the prohibition of smoking in restaurants was said to lessen business. It's going to hurt restaurants, and it's just been the opposite. I think.
Yeah.
Time has been told that, so. I think if
exactly.
you
all
hear
those
a lot
fears,
of
those fears, exactly.
Yeah.
I remember hearing that.
Empirically been proven to be wrong.
Restaurants were hearing they were going to go out of business, and it turned out to be the best
all
thing.
All the business would go to the towns that allowed.
Yeah.
Yeah. Didn't happen.
That's right. Other questions?
How do you make this less cool?
Oh, man.
She'll
yeah, exactly.
What kind of reception do you get when you talk to middle school kids? That much.
My grant doesn't.
They all think they're immortal.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, they are.
Yeah. My grant tries to focus me on training the trainers. So
okay.
I try to work with faculty, coaches, parents. I do go into schools whenever when I'm invited and when I have a chance. Kids are shocked when you say it's not harm free.
Yeah.
Because that they believe that it's harm free, and I'm learning more and more that some adults feel that way too. So it's a big education thing, and that's why we really need to get to the faculty, we need to get to curriculum leaders so they can get this into the curriculum, make sure that kids start hearing this now. Because kids do believe that smoking is bad for you.
Yeah.
They've been taught that, and they
actually
believe
it. And those same kids
that.
Will use that.
That's right.
Because it's not smoking.
But the same
it's
kids aren't really seen in the public. Role models do that. That part isn't there yet.
Of doing
e-cigarettes.
It's not. It's
you're
not
seeing
a big
it. You see it in Hollywood.
Yeah, if you
most kids
to
see that.
If you
don't
if
see everybody in a movie e-cigarette like
yeah.
they smoked in the 70s.
Yeah,
it's
right.
not happening.
If
yeah,
you,
yeah, not in the masses.
If you watch any of the awards shows, you see
okay.
actors and actresses, and where cigarettes Godfather. Have very tight restrictions on how they're advertised. You can't use cartoon characters
mm-hmm.
and that kind of thing.
Yeah.
I kind of like
newer
Joe
products.
Campbell, though. You know,
actually, now that you mentioned it, I didn't even
Joe
connect
Campbell
the dots.
Joe Campbell is back.
He is?
I didn't even connect the dots. So you've seen the ads for this on TV, and I haven't seen a cigarette ad in 30 years.
Yeah. We'll see
Marlboro, man.
Yep, you will see e-cigarettes.
I think the difference is there's no regulation that prevents a second or third kid from getting it, and it's got the cool factor. You know, Jimmy's got one, I want one, right?
Yep. Yeah.
Exactly
so
right.
The ripple effect is really quick.
And that's what, if you ask kids, why did you use it typically?
Mm-hmm.
A friend had one. It's cool.
Yeah.
And the flavors. And then Wakefield did a student survey. They surveyed, I think they got 50% of their high school students responded. And of the kids who vaped, they were asked the question, if you vape, would you vape if it wasn't flavored? And 65% said no.
Oh, interesting. Wow.
So flavor is a huge thing with them.
Well, the nicotine, I'm not sure if it has a perceptible taste. I wouldn't know, but I could imagine it's much easier to mask than smoke, so you end up with something that's... Have you thought, when I was a kid, the thing that always absolutely worked, at least in the 70s, was scared straight. You bring in somebody who's a real hard luck story, and you sit down, a half a dozen kids across, and give them a half an hour, and those kids will be straight for life, or at least 90% of them will be.
So that's turned around a lot. And what we don't show the black lung anymore. We don't do anything
like
that.
No, let them talk to somebody.
Kids, that's right. Kids don't scare. Because somebody said it. Kids are invincible.
Mm.
If you tell them that this causes that, They may believe it, but it won't happen to them.
Yeah.
I guess, but if somebody walks in with a stoma in their throat.
I know, you would, yeah.
Well, if it's Kurt Schilling, maybe.
Or if it's Kurt Schilling.
Schilling would have some effect, I think.
Yeah.
I hope he can do some PSAs, maybe Attorney General's
Office. As part of his settlement with the...
Public service announcements.
Yeah. Kurt is really, he's really a promoter, or, you know, he's really behind anything that he can do. One of the things he said was, if this change in, you know, assuming that Boston passes this ordinance, if this change in Boston keeps one 14-year-old from picking up dip, it would be worth it. The 14-year-old could be mine.
Yeah.
He really is, he was quite sincere. He used no notes, spoke from the heart. It was a really good, if you get a chance, it's probably on YouTube or something, if you get a chance to watch him, I encourage that, because
wow,
he did a really good presentation. And the kid from BU, the high school, the youth who spoke is a graduate of our 84. 84 is the tobacco program's youth group, and you have one here in Reading. He's a graduate of, I think, Watertown's 84 chapter, and he spoke, and he was amazing. He was the best speaker. Kurt had a tough time following. He did a good job, but he had a tough time following the kid.
This is someone who also was affected by smoking.
He told how he didn't use it. He told how prevalent it was, and how when he was playing baseball, that's what his role models were doing. That's what the pro players were doing. Luckily, he had some very good adult advisors, and he didn't get hooked. But he talks very eloquently about how important it is, and why pro ball players shouldn't be doing it on TV in front of Little League players.
The more you talk, the more I regret my colleague Mr. Halsey isn't here, because he's a huge youth sports, especially baseball, enthusiast. And I'm sure he'll look at this on YouTube on replay at some point. I'll encourage him to do that.
Exactly, yeah. I'm sure you can find it.
I wanted to see what you said tonight, too.
I'll send you a link that was sent to me by the Tobacco Free Mass people, which I believe has some snippets on it.
Mm-hmm.
So she sent it to those of us who were in support of the program. I'll forward that to you.
Other questions, gentlemen?
No, thank you.
Any questions from our audience today? A member for the Board of Health here, I see.
No, just really to listen to the presentation.
I do have one comment. I do believe there's a lot of misinformation on both sides. I don't believe it's totally marketed to kids. I mean, I'm all for people under 21 not using these products. But you go into the liquor store, they got a cotton candy block, a bubble gum block, and all that stuff, and it's geared to, you know, young adults. You know, you become 21, you don't turn black and white. You have, you know, flavors are nice, colors and everything, all marketing. I don't believe these marketing agencies say, hey, we want to market this to young kids. I don't think they would sign up for that. I myself would not sell to a 10-year-old. I don't think anybody in Woburn would sell a vape product to a 10-year-old. I think we have some morals in that regard. And they have nicotine, that they have zero nicotine liquids. And I think it has its place. It's a $2 billion industry.
Wow.
Just so everybody knows, it's huge. And
by itself?
Nationwide, $2 billion?
It is, and I do believe it is safer than smoking cigarettes.
No tar, at least. Yeah.
Yeah, all the carcinogenics. I mean, cigarettes are a burning tobacco, and this is a vaping. I think it is a safer alternative to smoking, and it does. Some people have quit, and some people do like to vape. I think it is a fad with the kids. I think it will work itself out, just like the hookah pot. I think the vaping pens and all that stuff will fade out, hopefully, eventually.
If people don't get addicted. The problem is that they're loaded with nicotine, and addiction is addiction. And if you
yes.
get addicted, you're going to need
it. And again, there is a zero, there's a three, there's a six, and, you know, people can, you know.
If they do that, that's right.
There are better products to vaporize with, and as these better products come out, and they do, they make these huge clouds, and, there are people that are into it for that reason. But as the better product comes out, I advise my customers to step down their nicotine, because they're getting a bigger cloud. They're probably getting more nicotine because of, you know, that. So I vape myself. I use a zero nicotine.
One concern I would have, okay, they don't like to smoke. Maybe they're going to try to join, but if they vape this, they might go to start vaping marijuana, which is very popular.
Mm-hmm. You're exactly right.
Thank you very much, Maureen. It's very, very
thank you all.
Thank you so much.
Great questions.
And
some questions I've heard before.
Yes.
Question.
We do have a question.
Hi.
Yes.
Just to share some information about if there are any potential health effects. As Maureen's noted, that at this point in time, e-cigarettes, except for those that are used for medical purposes, are not regulated by the FDA. There are regulations that are under consideration. They closed public comment on July 2nd, the FDA did. In addition to that, they have been, since the end of 2008, beginning of 2009, taking adverse reports from physicians, members of the public, public health officials, et cetera, relative to the health impact of for individuals that either use e-cigarettes or are exposed to e-cigarettes, the vapor and such other things. That's all available on the FDA website. And there is some indication that there are significant health impact and effects for both those who are users as well as those who are exposed, if you will, to secondhand vapor type of thing. So, you know, that's still an avenue. My understanding is that medical research is continuing to look into the issue. You know, conversations with physicians in emergency rooms and that type of thing has indicated that they are seeing an increased number of individuals coming in with a number of effects that are, let us say, unpleasant or require medical attention of some sort.
Thank you very much. Okay. Any other questions or comments? Thank you very much for coming
thank you,
in.
Thank
tonight.
You, well, thank you for your time and for having me
okay,
in.
Okay, we hope to
okay.
see you again on another occasion.
Good, thanks. I would appreciate that.
Okay. All right. We're now moving on to the final agenda item, which is the discussion of the town manager evaluation. You have before you a draft. I apologize if this was not on time for the packet, but it is here. A few words before we get into this. Bob, can you bring it up on the screen?
No, I didn't bring it.
You didn't bring it? That's okay. The process going forward, I'm going to give everybody a couple days to look this over.
Okay.
We're talking about this. If there's anything you would like to see reorganized, Bob, I'd especially like you to look at the part two there, because that was borrowed from some stuff about superintendents, and some of them may or may not be apropos. There may be a better way to organize it. Some things I should take out, some things I should put in. Any of that is fair game. I would ask that you send comments just to me and Bob, so we don't break any open meeting deliberation rules. So what we have here, if you go to page one, these are the two major pieces of the review. We have the goals, which we had on our review last year. I've done a summary section here. And goals will have one of three answers. Either the goal was not met, it was met, or it was exceeded. So that's pretty simple. And in subsequent pages three through five, you'll see the drill down on all the sub-goals. And this tracks the Reading 2020 structure that we discussed. One thing I would encourage you to do as you're working on this form, take out a packet from July 18th, our Saturday retreat, because that has the town manager's comments on it. And Bob, you're invited to do another self-review on this, of course. I would hope you would do that as well. We'll also do a summary sheet at the end that has everybody's response in one place, so figure out a format for that between now and then. So step one, did not meet or exceeded, and there's an area for comment at the end of the, there's an overall comment section on page two, and there's a comment section just for the goals. I don't know if we need both, but I'll put them both in there on page five. The other section that we've added, this is the standards proficiencies of being a town manager. I broke that into three major areas, leadership and professional culture is the first standard. This is, I'm on page one again. management and operations, and community engagement. And these are rated in four categories. Unsatisfactory needs improvement, where performance on a standard is below the requirements of the standard overall, but is not considered to be unsatisfactory at the time, but improvement is necessary. Proficient is actually a very good grade on this scale. Proficient practice is understood to be fully satisfactory. So that, excuse me, sorry about that. And the fourth grade is exemplary, and this is super duper. The rating of exemplary indicates that the practice in this particular area significantly exceeds proficient, that's the key words, and could serve as a model of practice regionally or statewide. So a grade of proficient is actually a very solid grade.
Okay. Dan, just curious, I've always felt that the tendencies towards these things is to have a greater number of grades. It's kind of like the Spinal Tap scene where the volume control goes up to 11. And I've always felt that that actually works against the objective.
I do too. Yeah.
You have three grades on the top, and we all get did not met and exceeded. Is there what's the logic behind the fourth on the
bottom? Well, I actually took one off that I could have left in on the top that was partially met, and I'm happy to put that back in if you think that would be a more balanced approach given the four there.
I was actually going to argue the contrary, that it's either even in the standards weren't met, they were met, or they were exceeded. And anything, I guess if you want to make it a model, it'll come out in quality of the work. It won't come up because of a checkbox.
I think it's important to have two grades, unsatisfactory and needs improvement. I mean, if someone is totally efficient
in an
area.
That's why you want to get it two.
Whereas goals, it's pretty, you can measure that better. You know, didn't make it, made it, and then some.
I see, that's where the fourth one is. Okay.
I'm happy to put a fourth back in if you think that would be better.
No, then the only, then Mike, I'll...
But I would defend the fourth.
That's fine, that makes sense, but then would you use the same language just for the sake of consistency?
What do you mean?
The same term?
I could throw some definitions in there, sure. They're similar to the, you talk about the definitions on page
Not
one.
Just the definitions, but deploy the same language for...
Oh.
Come up with your fourth example and name it.
You mean change, did not meet, met, exceeded?
Yeah.
Unsatisfactory.
And whatever needs improvement, transfer, or needs improvement, I guess.
Well, language is different for the goals. That's a met, didn't met versus degrees of proficiency.
Yeah, the goal seems more like a yes or no question.
That's like a...
The rest of it seems more of an opinion-based.
Yeah. And you want guidance for improvement. I think that's an important area to be checking if improvement needs it. And again, you can drill down the sub-goals. Some could be needs improvement, some could be proficient, and the overall could still be proficient.
Yeah.
If, you know,
I understand
in your opinion. The way, and we're going to leave it up to you guys how you weigh.
All right.
Now, if you go, as I said, pages 3-5 for the detailed goals, those right out of our July retreat. Same order, same definition for the comment section. Please look this stuff over on pages 6. Should be 6-8. Yep, thank you, Paula, putting the 8 in there.
Yeah.
I sort of cobbled this together from a form that's been used for the superintendents, and I think I weeded out all the school language. I probably left something in there. I think the first one is pretty good, but the others could maybe use a little beefing up or changing. Some may be a little bit duplicative from section to section here, but I thought they kind of hit the major tones. And the schools have this whole rubric that goes with the thing, saying, well, what's an unsatisfactory leadership? What's a needs improvement? And they give you a whole paragraph explaining it. I don't think we need that. That's a little much. That would be overkill, I think, to do that. So, a couple days to comment. I don't know, would it be unrealistic to ask for comments by Thursday so we can get these back out?
By email.
By email to me and Bob. Is that pushing it too much?
No, that works.
Because I don't want to lose time for the actual review, because that'll give me a full 2 weeks to do the review.
Right. Did you send this out to the full board or not?
Not yet. I wanted you guys to vet it. Actually, I think I sent it to John and an earlier copy to Barry, so not this one.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you're looking to beef up these last 2, 7, and 8 here?
Yeah. If you have any thoughts right now as you're looking through it, but we do have a whole time to do this.
while we're together here.
Bob, do you have any preliminary comments having seen this yourself, just in terms of form and...
Yikes. Dan sent it to me a little while ago, and I looked at it. I thought it was really good. I think it's especially helpful when you get beyond the goals in some way. Now, you don't want overkill.
No. Well, let me know if anything seems like gobbledygook to you.
Well, I think step two and pages 6 to 8 are kind of the same, and maybe could be put together in some way. And then the rest is goals, which could be put together. So if you will.
What do you mean step two?
It says step two, that's the one where there's standard one, standard two, standard three, and top page one.
Right.
I think if you combine what's above there and then the drill down on goals together in one section, that's helpful.
Okay.
You know, maybe you go through all the individual goals and then there's a summary at the end because you've just done the work of going through.
Oh, I see. So put the summary after the...
I think so. And then a whole separate section is this more, you know, less goal-oriented, more broad-oriented opinion-oriented.
I mean, is it this more to be an executive summary, I guess?
Well, that's true. It does read that way. I'm just thinking of how it's going to be kind of time-consuming to go through this and fill it out.
Yeah.
I'll look at 6 to 8 a little more carefully. But I really like step two, for
right.
instance.
Looking at it... probably use some improvement. Alrighty.
I'll get your things by tomorrow.
Okay. So close of business Thursday. Me and Bob, any comments would be really appreciated. Does anyone object to my reaching out to Marcy to see if she wants to participate? Bob, do you have any problem?
Not at all, if you can find her.
I have no idea where she is these days.
I'll send her email somewhere far away. I forget where at this point. Hopefully the yuan is holding up wherever she is.
Actually, it just got devalued today.
Not so much.
Oh, no.
Yeah,
maybe
today.
We'll see her back soon.
6.28, 6.32.
Hopefully she hadn't bought them all.
Yeah, right. But I will reach out and say, I think Barry will answer what he feels comfortable doing. He may or may not be able to answer all the questions. That's fine.
I think that's a good idea because I remember last year John Halsey saying as a new member
it's hard
to constrain.
That's all right.
Doing it in the summer.
So Thursday for comments on formal.
If you could,
yes.
Please.
Okay.
By email to me about it.
Yeah.
All right. Anything else? Any other issues to come before the board this evening? Hearing nothing, I will entertain a motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
Second. All in favor? We stand adjourned.
8:22.